Today we begin a new chapter in criminal law, and this begins the first building block in what is the sort of formula for the course. So as the slide indicates, we have on one hand the criminal act or actus reus that must be proven in every criminal prosecution in the United States. The second area we'll get to in the next chapter is called mens rea, dealing with the mental states of a defendant and the guilty mind they might have. It's not always required. There are some crimes that do not have mens rea, but it is, as we'll see, the overwhelming norm for criminal law. And then we'll get to affirmative defenses, both at the end of the course and then with some particular types of crimes called inchoate crimes, primarily attempt and conspiracy. Affirmative defenses are arguments that the defense makes even after the act requirement mens rea has been proven, they still should be found not guilty. So obvious examples of this are self-defense, justification, necessity, and duress. So we'll get to those later. For now, we need to focus on this sort of basic formula that will repeat itself over and over. We'll do the general rules of actus reus and mens rea, but then we'll apply them in more and more sections. So when we get to attempted crimes, for example, we'll look at the act requirements and mens rea. When we look at accomplice liability, we'll look at the act requirements and mens rea. When we get to rape and homicide, we'll look at the act requirements and mens rea. So this formula is something that you'll see over and over. And the important thing first is to learn the basic building blocks. The building block of actus reus in act requirements is the subject of this chapter. So every crime needs an act requirement. And importantly, every crime must have not just a criminal act, but one that is voluntary. Now, voluntary is a tricky word in criminal law. We're going to use voluntary a few times this semester, and each time it will mean something a little different. And I'm sorry for that, but that's just the way criminal law is. So, for example, when we say voluntary manslaughter, means something totally different. When we talk about voluntary abandonment as an affirmative defense, something totally different. So voluntariness is a word that's used and abused throughout criminal law. And what it means here in terms of act requirements is also maybe not what you think the word means, or at least it's far narrower than you might think. So to look at voluntariness, I first think it's helpful, and I've included in the text a list of examples of situations where there's a clear legal rule that if a person is in this state and it makes the acts of the crime not an act of free will or volition, then they are not guilty, right? They should not even be charged. Then there's a category, impaired consciousness, where depending upon the particular facts, we might think a person is making, or their actions are involuntary, and therefore they are not criminally liable for them. Now, both of these lists that I'm going to go through that are included in the text are not exhaustive. There isn't one court opinion or set of court opinions that really lays out the entirety of the voluntariness doctrine. Rather, these are pieces that have been assembled by scholars who look at cases across the country and say, this is, you know, what we can infer based on different rulings. But as we'll see when we look at the court cases, and we have four in this section of our act requirement chapter, one of them shows how courts can completely mangle this analysis and get entirely confused because it is a rarity, right? It is a rarity as a doctrine that emerges in cases. For the most part, when somebody robs a bank, we don't see a claim that it was involuntary, right? That they didn't mean to rob a bank, that they were out of their mind. That's simply not the case. Similarly, I just used the colloquialism out of their mind, and it's important to recognize this is not the same as insanity. Insanity is a separate doctrine, which is also extremely narrow and may not even be required anymore in every state based upon a recent Supreme Court ruling about Kansas's law in the area. And so voluntariness is you know, a set of circumstances, or I should say involuntariness is, a set of circumstances where you do not think somebody is capable of committing the acts required for the crime because of some very unique specialized conditions. So let's go through the examples, because voluntariness and involuntariness are concepts that are really defined through example. The model penal code and the Missouri statute included in the text, they don't really add really any new information about the meaning of the word, and it's still unclear after looking at both of them what voluntariness means. So examples are the best way for us to learn. So we focus on this category called involuntary acts. This is situations where the defendant should not be liable. This is sort of a cut and dried rule that if these circumstances apply and they prevented them from either committing the acts they were required to do or made them commit the acts that they're not supposed to do, then they're not guilty. This is a complete get out of jail free category. So the first is physical coercion. And here the phrase might, you know, physical coercion, the label might mislead you. You might think, well, somebody threatens to beat you up unless, say, you go rob the corner store of an apple. That's not what we mean by physical coercion. Physical coercion is really focused on, as the slide indicates, domino-type actions. So let's say you're standing on the corner waiting for a bus. There's a crowd of people. The bus is coming, but it's actually going really fast. There's somebody right in front of you, and somebody pushes you from behind. You then fall into the person in front of you who gets run over by the bus. You have committed an act that caused the death of the other, which is what homicide laws require. But the act wasn't voluntary. It was very much a domino effect. Somebody pushed you, you fell into somebody else. And so the person behind you can be held liable. Their act was voluntary, but yours was not. And so physical coercion is a very narrow situation where we're really talking about these sort of cascading effects, not situations where you're threatened with violence. That is not physically coercive involuntary act. The next category is reflex. Also, the label here can be a little misleading. These were labels that have been in common law for a long time, and so we use them because that's the doctrine the courts recognize, even though the labels are sometimes confused. You might think of reflex simply as when you go to the doctor's office, they hit your knee and it moves slightly upward. Sure, if you had kicked your doctor doing that ever so slightly, that might have been a battery that was involuntary, but really is a physically coercive category because it's sort of a domino effect of them hitting your knee. Strangely, the example that often comes up in the context of reflex is a swarm of bees, which is why the slide is what it is. So you might imagine a couple situations, very unlikely, but we can imagine them, where a swarm of bees causes you to commit a crime. So let's say a swarm of bees descends upon you and you start flailing your arms madly. And in that context, you hit somebody in the head, right? That's a battery, but it's considered a reflex involuntary act because your flailing is part of you dealing with the fact that there's bees descending upon you and stinging you all over. Perhaps a better example, although still uncommon, is what happens if at least a decent number of bees enter your car while you're driving. That doesn't necessarily cause your arms to flail wildly, but it can be very difficult to focus. And let's say you crashed into another car and would commit some form of crime dealing with that property damage and that accident if somebody was injured. But again, we'd say the act is involuntary. So reflex is also a very narrow category. There's not a lot of cases here. And the bees is kind of the classic example here. There can be other situations, though, and certainly it would be other bugs or animals, situations where somebody is not in control. They often revolve around driving, right? So things that really prevent you from driving because of some physical harm that's come to you or physical fear that's come to you. Then we get to paralysis or contraction. And really, paralysis is sort of the big part of this category. Now, you might think, well, if somebody's truly paralyzed and is opposed to contraction where they have some muscle movements that are involuntary, how could they commit a crime? Well, after this section in the Act requirements, our next section is called crimes by omission, meaning crimes where a person's failure to act is actually what makes them culpable and makes them so they can be prosecuted under criminal law. Crimes by omission are also a narrow category, but you can see if somebody is paralyzed, either temporarily or permanently, they wouldn't be able to commit those acts. So paralysis really revolves around these crimes by omission scenario. So let's say, for example, somebody is a lifeguard. They have an obligation to try and rescue people that are drowning. Most of us don't, but a lifeguard has an employment duty. But somebody hits them over the head with a hammer. They are react by having some sort of seizure that paralyzes them and because of the brain damage involved. And as a result, they are paralyzed temporarily. And so if somebody drowns And they didn't act. We would say, no, it was an involuntary act because they were paralyzed at the time. Again, very rare, very narrow categories here. Similarly to paralysis, unconsciousness, right? Truly unconscious, meaning you are in a state of no physical movement or awareness, and we associate this primarily with crimes of omission, right? If you're unconscious, so instead of having somebody have the lifeguard have a seizure that paralyzed them, let's just say it knocked them out. And if it knocks them out and somebody drowns, they are not liable because it's an involuntary act due to unconsciousness. Okay, so these are four examples that, we say there's a pretty bright line here. If these facts exist and they are related to the criminal acts, what be them omissions or acts of commission, either way, they are situations where somebody should not be prosecuted. The next category, impaired consciousness, is a little trickier. And this these situations, we have to do a fact intensive analysis. It's very case by case. So sometimes there are going to be situations here where we'd say the defendant is not guilty at all. But other times we'll say, no, they're still acting voluntarily. And you'll see this as we go through the examples. And again, this list is not exhaustive. It just includes examples of impaired consciousness that have been recognized in jurisdictions. So the first is a concussion. So I'm guessing many of you have had a concussion before. I have. I think my worst concussion was playing on a lawyer's basketball team in New York. I managed to get a double hit on my head, which is often sort of a trigger, where I was driving, I got an elbow, and then my head hit the floor. I don't remember anything after that until the middle of the next day when I was reviewing documents, and I was like, how did I get here? I also pointed out that somebody should redo all my work because it may not have been done with the greatest awareness or intention. So that's a pretty severe concussion because I had a blackout. Had I gone on a crime spree after, say, I was at the basketball game, let's say I went to the corner store, and I didn't commit like violent crime to start beating people up, but I just grabbed some food and left without paying for it. Well, am I free to go? Can I use a concussion as a way to escape liability, as a loophole? Well, it's going to depend. Experts will probably have to testify about the nature of my concussion. They'll have to assess and testify as to basically my general awareness of my surroundings and whether or not I knew what was going on. And it's possible I would be not guilty. It is going to be the burden on the prosecution beyond a reasonable doubt to prove I was acting voluntary. On the other hand, people have concussions all the time and don't commit crime. So it's going to be a pretty rare instance where this will result in either the judge dismissing the charges or an instruction going to the jury and they return a not guilty verdict. But it's possible. So a concussion, which is a form of brain damage, it can affect the way we process information about the world around us. And forgetting pain, something might be an example. Now, if you have a concussion, this does not mean you can go around and start murdering people and expect no charges. I would hope you wouldn't do that. The next is sleepwalking. Generally, that's what we're talking about here with this category. Sleepwalking or actions while you're asleep, you'll notice are distinguished from unconsciousness, right? That's why I was saying unconscious meaning truly out of the world, not there. Some people have, they move, they talk, they can get up and walk around while asleep, and we don't fully understand why this occurs. And it's a real thing. I didn't fully understand it until I married my wife, and I woke up a couple of times to her hitting me in the head. One time she was very alarmed at a red dot on the wall. It was not there. And she hit me. She's my wife. I forgave her. But I also came to realize over the years that she was completely out of it. We've actually sort of developed a rapport where I can tell her, no, you're really asleep. Go back to sleep. And she'll have no memory of these sort of events. The law will protect this in very narrow situations, like so. Her battery of me is not criminal because it was an involuntary act. But there are some ugly cases here where defendants have tried to assert sleepwalking, which the courts have rejected. But we want to, again, be careful about how we define this because our medical understanding ability to retroactively diagnose it is difficult. So there was, for example, a person who was a longtime accused child molester of their child, and they argued that they were doing it while sleepwalking. And the jurors rejected that. They didn't find it credible. And so, yeah, yes, sleepwalking exists. Yes, it's possible to get crimes. It's extremely extremely rare, and we don't want it to be a category where any defendant could just say, oh, I was asleep while that was happening. Then we have high and low blood sugar. So for those of you who are older or enjoy older stuff, I can't believe I'm calling it older, you might remember Beavis and Butthead. Beavis would consume large amounts of sugar and caffeine and turn into a character known as the Great Cornholio. And the Great Cornholio, with this incredibly high blood sugar level, would often do a lot of bad things, including things that were probably criminal. He would arguably be committing involuntary acts and not liable when he had assumed his Great Cornholio persona. But this happens in a much more realistic environment with people who have trouble controlling their blood sugar, particularly diabetics. And so sometimes they will reach states where they are not as aware of their surroundings. And in those circumstances, we can say that it was an involuntary act. But there is going to be a caveat to, say, diabetics, and we'll talk also about epileptics and other conditions that come and go that are at least partially treatable. In those situations, courts have often instructed juries that people are liable for their voluntary acts of, say, not taking their medication or doing things that they're not supposed to do. So it's a little trickier there, and we'll delve a little more detail into that later. So we have perhaps a GIF you've seen online before that shows a large fake monster jumping out of a garbage can and getting punched in the face. And I'll just let it run while I talk here. Is this an involuntary act, just based on what we've looked at so far without going into the cases? And invariably in the past, students have said, yeah, that's a reflex, right? You know, that's just a quick reaction. No, this is a voluntary act. I know a monster and a swarm of bees, how do we distinguish them? But this person thinks there's a genuine threat, right? Jumping from the garbage can, and they punch it. Now, this doesn't mean they're guilty, right? This may mean that they were acting in what we call reasonable self-defense, right? Mistaken self-defense. They thought there was a threat that there wasn't there. But this act is intentional. Just because you have quick reflexes in the fighting context does not mean all your punches and kicks or whatever physical form your reactions take are excused by the law or not covered by the criminal law. There might be other reasons this defendant is not guilty, but this does not fit our categories. And that's one of the things I want to emphasize here is that the categories for involuntary acts are extremely limited. And even in cases that here where we think defendants have very good claims to their acts being involuntary, you see that courts are reluctant to extend involuntariness, I should say, to cover more than is absolutely necessary for the criminal law. Okay, so that's sort of our basic background here and what requires a voluntary act. We then go through four cases here. Now, Martin v. State is, you know, you might look at it and say, why are we reading an intermediate appellate court from Alabama in 1944? It's a pretty brief opinion. Doesn't seem like that much happens. Well, as you notice in our later case, it's still cited quite regularly from jurisdictions across the United States. You know, old chestnut is perhaps an overused phrase by law professors, but Martin definitely fits this category because courts still refer to it. And it's perhaps because of the simplicity of the voluntariness analysis here and the mistake that some courts are prone to make, which is voluntariness does not have to be written into the statutes. Now, I've said this course is all about statutes, and you start with statutes. There are very few doctrines that change the way we interpret statutes, right? The last chapter focused on some of the constitutional limits on interpretation. But otherwise, the doctrines are mostly in the background or have been codified. And indeed, as we see with the Missouri statute, many states have codified voluntariness separately. But even if they haven't, as was the case in Alabama in this era, voluntariness is always a requirement to every criminal act. It's just implicit in our criminal law. And so the facts of Martin themselves are also kind of fun in a weird way, which is we have a defendant who is behaving horribly and they are intoxicated, but they're home. You know, they are not in a public location. And so public intoxication requires both that the intoxication exist and that it be in a public place. And so you can almost appreciate the bizarre ingenuity here of the police who say, well, we'll just take him to a public location, right? We'll take him onto the highway. And there he continued to be loud and use profanity. And so this seems like the statute applies. After all, he is now manifesting a drunken condition in a boisterous and indecent way. He's loud and profane. And we have both act requirements, right? Or one, if you want to group it together, public intoxication. But as the appellate court rightly points out, the moving to the public was not voluntary, right? The police took him without a choice to a public location. And had he stayed on his private property, there was no crime at all. So the involuntariness occurs because of the police compulsion here. This is a form of perhaps physical coercion, or it might be a separate category in our list, right? It's not quite a domino effect, but resisting the police is itself going to open new crimes, and the compulsion of the state is going to fit as an involuntary act. But it's not a clean fit, so if you wanted to say it's a separate category, that's quite possible. You notice the court here doesn't try to categorize it, and instead just reaches the conclusion. The opinion is very short, and it is discussed regularly. So that's our basic rule. But you'll see it gets more complicated. And indeed, it's good to keep Martin in mind as you're thinking about these other cases, particularly the latter two, because you might think the newer cases don't treat the Martin doctrine or the doctrine that Martin was espousing, the Martin court was espousing, the judge in it, that they're being true to it, right? They might, in fact, have softened the doctrine a bit or made it less defendant-friendly. So we get to our next case, which is Torres. Now, it's worth noting, because this is a military court case, that the military has a separate criminal justice system embodied in the UCMJ, the Uniform Code of Military Justice. But for our purposes, it's just another jurisdiction, just like another state. There are some crimes under the UCMJ that don't exist broadly, like conduct unbecoming an officer or something like that. But it also is very true to common law traditions and model penal code traditions, because at the time the UCMJ was found, the model penal code was sort of a big thing. And you'll notice the court here talk about the model penal code's definition of voluntariness and trying to analyze the facts of this case. So it's also important, in addition to the UCMJ piece, to notice that the majority and dissent here agree on something, which is that the lower court messed up here. The lower court is in error by not giving a voluntariness instruction. That doesn't mean they think the defendant's not guilty, right? The majority, in fact, upholds the conviction. But it's sometimes important to recognize that when you have a dissent and a majority, that there can be agreement on certain components that are very important to our course. And in fact, there's no doubt here, I think, that the defendant should have received a voluntariness instruction at the lower court at trial so that the fact finder could then assess it. Right. So the fact finder could assess it. Instead, what happened was there was testimony on voluntariness, but not a jury instruction. And if you don't tell the jurors how it matters, well, that can create a problem. Right. Then the doctrine's not being properly applied. And so here we have a defendant who assaulted his wife in what he says was an altered state of consciousness that followed an epileptic seizure. But it followed it by quite a bit here. Right. We're talking 20 to 30 minutes. Nonetheless, the burden is on the prosecution to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the act was voluntary. And the experts in the case do testify that sometimes in this post-seizure state, people are still in an involuntary situation. They still are acting without full control of their faculties. But you'll notice that 20 to 30 minutes really seems not just unusual, but maybe unprecedented. And this was true not just for the government's expert witness, who was a neurologist, who said this was highly unlikely, but also the defendant's own expert testified on cross-examination that it was highly improbable the appellant assaulted his wife due to the effects of being in this. So even if he was in a state that was impaired, saying that was the reason he assaulted his wife is difficult to justify. And for that reason, the majority says this is what we call a harmless error. So it was an error. But the evidence was so overwhelming, even the defense evidence, it was all admitted, it wouldn't have made a difference, is essentially what it's saying. That's a close call, right? Because the dissenters say this error was not harmless, that it should go back. And that doesn't, as I said, mean the defendant's not guilty. It just means he should be retried, the evidence should be represented, and this time the jury is instructed as to the voluntariness rule. And as I said, it can go either way. It's a judgment call here. I think that the defendant's claim is pretty far-fetched and unlikely, but that does not mean they shouldn't get to present it because there is an underlying medical condition here that is well documented. People during seizures have committed crimes, and that's different, right? There was a very tragic case that came out of Virginia that just absolutely horrific, where a mother had grand mal seizures that she actually could function in many ways. Most people have seizures or not in a capacity to move or operate things, and she and the medical evidence seemed to support, she actually put her small baby in a microwave. And it seemed that she believed she was putting the milk bottle because the baby was crying. And they were able to trigger seizures and film them and document that she could have a lot of this functionality there. And they ended up pleading the case out. So there are these other categories, right, of seizures and unconsciousness, but this is different, right? And they are all very tragic fact patterns, or not all, but many are just very awful, not as lighthearted as Martin, and that's the nature of criminal law. So that's the Torres case. Now, the Collins case, the first discussion question note indicates this is a horrible opinion. And I just want to be absolutely clear on that point. Why do we read horrible opinions? Well, one is they show errors that we can then try not to repeat, right? Sometimes we learn more from not just our own mistakes, which we definitely can learn from, but other people's mistakes. And I want to say that this court just messes it up across the board. In fact, I think there's three major mistakes that we want to talk about in class. So I won't list them here, but I want to go through the facts and sort of emphasize maybe these are some points that are problematic. So in this case, we have Collins, who has consumed PCP, but based on the evidence, it seems to be it was entirely involuntary, right? That she had stopped by a party. It was in this drink that tasted like fruit punch, and it had been dosed, right? This is something where she is arguably involuntarily consuming the drug, and it's a drug that she's never used. And so when she then drives her car, we have a witness there who can testify exactly what happened. So it's not just Collins' impaired testimony and impaired memory. We have someone else saying that she basically becomes non-responsive. She says she has a headache. She goes through five or six stop signs without stopping. The friend is yelling at her, telling her to stop. She begins to swerve into oncoming traffic. Eventually, she applies the brake, and the friend steers the car off the road. And at this point, Collins, our defendant, loses consciousness. So, during this window of time, she seems to be behaving in an altered state, right, where she is not conscious. And I think it's notable that she, based on the evidence we have, did not take this drug voluntarily. And yet, despite all these facts that seem to indicate involuntariness, the court upholds the conviction here. And they uphold the conviction even though the instructions to the jury and the law is a mess here. Because the court is itself, and we're not sure about how much the trial court did this, but it's reasonable to think they made the same mistakes, is conflating and combining all these different areas where intoxication matters in our law. So there is intoxication can cause involuntary acts in certain circumstances. We might particularly think so if the person consumed the intoxicant involuntarily. But then intoxication can appear in the mens rea level. It can affect somebody's state of mind, and we'll get to that. That'll vary based on certain rules and jurisdictions. But there's also some jurisdictions like Pennsylvania that have a affirmative defense or a separate doctrine dealing with intoxicant consumption. And just because it appears in all three places does not mean they're all the same, right? They can intoxication is relevant for three different inquiries, but the court is constantly jumping back and forth between them here. And the court does have this sort of rhetorically powerful argument, which is how could somebody be not guilty of DUI for involuntariness? Because then everyone who's DUA will say, oh, I was so drunk, I was so intoxicated that I'm not guilty for my DUI. That would seem to undermine the DUI law. And that does seem to be a good point, right? But again, our defendant here didn't take the intoxicant voluntarily, right? That's how we can deal with the DUI cases. We could say, well, maybe they didn't, voluntarily drive because they were blacked out and they were out of control, but they did voluntarily consume, say, that 15th drink and decide whatever, these prior decisions. And so we can move our frame of reference for voluntariness to these prior moments in time. It's sort of a fudge of the doctrine, right? It's not perfectly consistent, but it's something. But the court here is then, focusing on the statute has intentionally, knowingly, and willfully in many crimes, but not this one. And it's like, those are all mens rea words. Those don't have anything to do with the analysis here. And so they ultimately say the court, and this is, you know, the quote from the opinion, the Commonwealth was not required to prove that Collins' intoxication was intentional or voluntary. Now, intentional, well, that might be true. That's a mens rea. We're going to leave that. But voluntary, definitely. And intentionally, maybe. I'm not going to say it's a... Yes, you have to prove. That's what State v. Martin said, right? You know, this is very clear that voluntariness exists for every crime. Now, we might look at voluntariness differently in the context of a DUI, right? Whether or not the person willingly took it, what other circumstances were going on. Sometimes drug interactions can be problematic. And sometimes they're idiosyncratic, meaning that, or idiopathic, if we're going to use the medical term, meaning that a person has a unique drug reaction or interaction that no one else would. So, yes, they became intoxicant through voluntary actions, but the combination is what was really the trigger for, say, these altered states. And so this opinion's bad. And what it's important to do here is to see these mistakes and not make them. So why did the court make such a bad ruling here? Well, as I said, voluntariness is a very narrow doctrine. Cases rarely come up. So a lot of judges never see them, right? This is not something that appears frequently. And maybe the only knowledge they had about it was their 1L criminal law class, and they've probably forgotten that. And it's easy. They may have never practiced, or for somebody who's, even somebody who's practiced criminal law, but especially somebody who's never practiced it, to just look at intoxication, see it in the briefs and the statutes, or hear it argued, and just combine it all into one big blob of rule, right? So you have your intoxication rule, but that's not how it works. Intoxication should be handled separately under each place within our doctrine. Usually that's just in the act requirement and mens rea. Occasionally, there's also these affirmative defenses or separate standards or doctrines as well. And so this ruling, I think, is wrong, and I think Collins was wronged here. But this happens. This happens from time to time. Okay, then we get to our last case, and this is adding another level of complexity. Now, this opinion is not necessarily bad or good. It's a difficult issue. And the good thing about the opinion as it's written is the court discusses the fact that some jurisdictions have followed the approach that it does, but others haven't, particularly Oregon, right? So they discuss the Oregon case Tippetts. So we sort of get two different perspectives on how to deal with situations like this. So what are effects? Well, prison contraband's the issue, right? That people smuggle things into prison, and they often do it in pretty extreme ways. You might know some people, you know, swallow bags of drugs to get into prison, and then it comes out the other end. Sometimes bribery guards. I mean, in truth, the biggest source of contraband for prisons is usually somebody in the inside being complicit. You can get much larger supplies, and it's a major problem, right? And so, of course, they include a lot of things. This is an older slide here, so you see the cell phones are a little ancient, but cell phones are a hot commodity, and they're very common in some prisons, despite the fact that they are illegal. And so this is something that is just a reality. Now, this defendant here was not intending to smuggle things in prison, right? And that's and that intention is perhaps a mens rea issue, but we need to focus on the act requirement, right? They also weren't voluntarily, at least arguably, trying to import things here. Because our defendant is apprehended, and they are arrested. And, you know, that arrest doesn't really matter. It's just that they're arrested, similarly to how Martin was seized in State v. Martin. And they're being brought to a county jail here. Now, at this point, the defendant has been asked several times, do you have any drugs or guns? Do you have any drugs or guns? And in truth, there was probably a failure of policing here, because at the point of arrest, police usually do a full pat-down that finds anything. But it's possible a small baggie might elude them. But once you have an arrest, you get a search incident to arrest. And that's a doctrine you can explore in the criminal procedure course. And so our defendant here, you know, is you know, kind of in this weird pickle, right? This sort of a rock and a hard place. It's not clear what they thought would happen or that they were really planning, but they don't want to disclose that they do have illegal drugs still, because then they will be charged with that possession. They probably don't realize, or maybe they're not sure of the fact that if they bring it into prison, that itself might be a crime. But merely being in a hard situation is not what makes the voluntariness argument viable here. The idea is he is physically being brought into a jail with a substance. I'm sure he could have disclosed it earlier, But it's not, the court doesn't say you initially have an obligation to disclose. It's tricky to figure out the nature of the crime here. The real focus is the importation of the marijuana on him into the jail, is that itself a voluntary act? And all the other evidence here is slam dunk, right? Once the detention officer searches at the jail and finds the container in one of the defendant's pockets, which had 790 milligrams of marijuana, our defendant says, "Oh man, I worked hard for that chronic." So he pretty much says, asserts possession. And that's the whole case, right? There's not much else. But this voluntariness issue for the importation crime, which is more serious, is tricky, right? It's tricky here. How does the court resolve it? Well, the court ultimately thinks that the possession and maybe the failure to disclose are voluntary acts. And so they uphold the conviction. In contrast, the Oregon court in Tippetts reached the opposite conclusion. It said they're still on the hook for the original crime they were charged with, but and for the possession, right? So they can be charged with simple possession because they were possessing it. But the importation just seems difficult, right? It seems difficult to apply the act requirement here. And so these are two different ways of looking at the issue, and both are reasonable. As you'll, the Arizona court notes, they're the majority approach. And they even discuss State v. Martin, right? And they distinguish Martin because Martin does seem a little in contrast with this, right? In both cases, we have the power of the state, the police, moving someone from one location to another. One case, it was to a public highway. In this case, it's to a jail. But in Martin, the defendant was, not guilty. In this case, they say he is. And so the court tries to distinguish it here. We can discuss whether you find that distinction persuasive. But there's a very pragmatic sort of rationale, I think, embedded in the Arizona court's opinion, which is, they had a chance. They had a chance to disclose it and just get the possession charge by waiting after repeated no's to get to the jail. They think that became a voluntary act. And courts can go either way on this, right? There is no strong rule. It might be a little inconsistent with Martin. We'll discuss that. But this is sort of the architecture of the modern voluntariness doctrine, right? The cases are extremely rare. Involuntary acts are defined very narrowly. We'll look at some more examples in class. But it is an absolute requirement, and that's why the Collins opinion is wrong. It should be in every crime, right? Even crimes that themselves involve intoxication. It's just we might change how the voluntariness doctrine works. So that's our first step in learning about act requirements. We'll continue on next time by looking at different types of acts that trigger criminality.